In the center of a vast but secret forest stands a mighty oak. A majestic tree that was already a sapling when the world was young. It is even said that from its wood, the ancients crafted the first humans and animals. In oak, you are the leader of one of four different druidic orders. Your goal is to bring honor to the oak, so as to be selected to learn its secrets. Will you be able to prove to the oak that your order is worthy? Will you be able to unlock the secrets of the ancients?
Is it secret? Is it safe?
Is that a thing?
Oak.
Is that a thing?
You guys know what that's from, right?
No.
Nope.
Get out of my house.
Is it Willow?
That's Gandalf, bro.
Oh.
What?
Stay on the board, boys.
Oak.
Okay, I'll be leaving now.
Hey everybody, welcome to Season 12, Episode 3 of the Board Boys Podcast. Tonight on the docket is Oak by Game Brewer. This is your Board Boy Rob.
It's your Board Boy TK.
Your Board Boy Jake.
And rounding out the quartet is your Board Boy, Oaker McDoker, a.k.a. DJ Steve Trees.
Big Oaker McDoker. That's what they call him. He carries a big stick silently.
Yeah.
And don't try to quote any movies around him.
I know.
Or
I know.
You'll just get real angry.
I know Cannibal. I know every word of Cannibal the Musical. I know.
It's very much you, yeah.
I know a lot of Troll 2.
I know a lot of Troll 2.
Like Troll 2, the Pixar movie? Or
no,
whatever?
Troll 2, the one where they're eating her. Now they're going to eat me. Oh, my God. You know that movie?
No.
I thought you also meant Trolls, too.
Yeah, I know, too. Yeah.
So Troll 2.
Big Anna Kendrick fan?
Yeah. the three people with the kids.
So Troll
Trolls,
2.
Huh?
So Troll 2 is a movie that this Italian guy wrote in English. It's a movie about a vegetarian goblins that turn people into vegetables and then eat them. He wrote the movie in English, went and filmed it in, like, outside of Salt Lake City with all American amateur actors, and then he was like, he ruled the dialogue with an iron fist and made the American amateur actors deliver the lines the way he thought they should be said. It's maybe the best bad movie of all time. I think it beats The Room.
So it's almost as famous as Lord of the Rings then.
Yeah, almost. Okay. And they gave it the name Troll 2 because Troll, the movie Troll in the 1980s, I guess, was kind of successful. And so the studio is like, yes, you can make this movie, but you have to call it Troll 2. And there's not a troll in the movie, and the goblins are always referred to as goblins.
So philosophically, if you take meat and magically turn it into vegetables, does that make it vegetarian?
If you
kill a human to turn them into a vegetable, is that still cannibalism?
I don't know.
You mean like if I have a magic spell that turns you into a carrot and then I eat you?
Yeah. Well, like these goblins, right? They don't eat meat, but they turn people into vegetables.
They sure like the bone. Yeah.
I mean, I don't think they're good guys. Yeah. I don't think they're not hypocrites. But what I always think about with vegetarian food, okay, here's the thing. I think there's lots of good reasons to be a I think you can have a lot of, there's a lot of good reasons for dietary choices. But what I always wonder is why people I know who think that eating meat is immoral want to eat meat substitutes. I would get why somebody who thinks it's like unsustainable, but for people who think like it's not right and it's not natural to eat meat, well, why are you eating fake meat? Why are you eating soybeans?
But in a lot of cases, it's like black bean burgers. So it's black beans.
Right.
But what I'm saying is, like, I like black bean burgers, and I think they taste like black beans. I don't think they taste like beef, but what's the...
Because people
But why are you trying to eat impossible burgers, then?
Because it's protein. I don't think people are being like, oh, man, I want to go eat a fake hamburger.
Oh, no, I have vegetarian friends that are.
Well, but in a lot of cases, too, it's an animal is sentient and they don't want to consume something that is that way. So if it's artificial, then they're still getting protein and consuming something that is a popular cuisine without killing the sentient animal.
I want to die in the hill. It's just something I've thought about because, like, I don't really have a problem with it. But I always wonder is, like, if you think it's so wrong to eat meat, then why are you drawn to something you think is like the artificial version of something?
There
wrong?
Is like the I don't know, the debate about the synthesized fake meat using animal proteins.
Oh yeah,
like is that acceptable or not? For me, I don't care. But
well, I'm not vegetarian, but like if I was vegetarian, it would be for the reasons of like. Maybe I don't think it's wrong to eat meat, but I do think that the industry's messed up, and I think that like it's easier to grow plants than it is to like raise a cow. And so for me, it's like, well, if I'm eating an Impossible Burger, it's because I think it's fine to eat a burger, but I don't want to put a cow through and the economy through what it takes for me to get a burger. But I don't know.
Well, I mean, I'm a pescatarian. I only eat fish that has eaten other fish.
That's pretty funny, Rob.
All right. Also a quote from a show.
Oh.
So... anyway.
I'm a pesca pizzatarian. I only eat fish that's eaten a pizza.
Those chicken tenders you ordered earlier beg to differ.
Buddy, I think I'm going to have bad heartburn tonight because I ate 8 chicken tenders. Yeah,
those chickens ate a pizza before they...
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
That's good.
I only eat pizza-fed chicken.
Yeah. I only eat sentient pizza.
It's a niche
pizza,
market.
Like, I only eat Pizza the Hut type pizza, which is like a living pizza
the
mound.
Big thing in town now is they're trying to push for... Ankeny wants... There's a... People want to start like having chickens in town because of the avian flu, and eggs are $50 a dozen.
Bro, eggs are pricey. Yeah. Hey, next time I go down to Peru, my father-in-law, he's in the egg business. I bet I could bring back a bunch of eggs cheap. I'll get an extra seat.
In your carry-on?
I'll get an extra seat on the plane and just have a stack of egg cartons. Hey, could you guys be a little careful taking off?
Yeah, you could probably make a profit on that.
Yeah.
It would be exactly like... The entire thing would be Kramer trying to make more money with cans by driving to Michigan. That is exactly how
that is that's a Kramer stunt. Yeah. It's like
I literally just finished rewatching Seinfeld again.
He and Newman like crunching the numbers on how many eggs have to be in the seat for them to sell them at a
how many you can carry in the plane. Yeah.
Rob, did you watch it on Netflix?
Yeah.
Were you angered by the shot being different? Because isn't it like it's a different? I remember reading a big thing. Netflix did it in a different, like, the dimensions, and there were things from how it was previously shot, and there are things you can't see. I don't remember that. Maybe they changed it, but there's a big backlash.
When I binge watch things I've seen before, I tend to just have it on in the background, so I don't notice those kind of things. It's like I can quote most everything that's going on in the thing anyway. You watch all the episodes, and I'm like, oh, yeah, that's this one. And I don't know. It's more just like background noise to me almost. So
fair enough.
It didn't. That's the second time I've watched it on Netflix, but I didn't notice anything.
Okay, they might have changed it too, but I know it was a big thing right when it came on Netflix.
Huh. I mean, I can't imagine it'd be different camera angles or anything.
I think
like,
it's
they
just
didn't
like
reshoot
the
it, but it's probably like probably just like a. Well, back then it wasn't widescreen.
I think that's what it was.
Right,
they made it that way.
So when it's widescreen, you lose like. It just will change the shot, so some things might be out of
so there was
frame,
something, I think the big example it gave was there was some scene, I don't remember what it was about, but like they're pointing to like a manhole cover or something, and you can't see it in the shot because the guy,
there's the one where George's keys fall into the thing that gets paved over, and then every time they drive over it, the keychain's like, holy cow! Whoever that Yankees announcer is. But the thing I've noticed much about like rewatching it is just, first of all, some of the topics they talk about, I'm like, oof, like if they like that would be on TV today almost. And then second, they have so many issues that just don't exist today because of like, let me check my messages, or I gotta let me call them, or let me use this payphone, or like.
I love thinking about the number of movies that are irrelevant because of cell phones, like Jingle All the Way with Arnold Schwarzenegger. Like that movie's fixed with just
cell there's phones. So many things. It's just like. Like, let me call him to check my messages. Like,
well, you know, now when they make movies, they always have to throw that scene in of, like, the cell phone flying out the window and stuff like that or so that they can do their movie. Yeah.
Yeah. We flew into the Bermuda Triangle. Yeah, we have no cell reception. Well, this is a board games podcast, and even though I have been dead the last week, I did play a couple of games. Two of them we already kind of talked about, so I'm just going to gloss over them. Sabika, still liking it. still going to be an episode on it. I've also played it solo. I could talk about that more when we do the episode, but solo was good.
Is that your... you played it three times?
I played it three or four times now, cool. Yeah. Bonfire, Trees and Creatures. Just go back to the last episode. I did play the solo mode of that. The solo mode of Bonfire is awesome. It's super easy to play, and it's just a deck of cards that just takes actions and takes things off the board. Like, it's super, super easy to play. And so if you're a solo player and you liked what we thought about Bonfire, I think the solo mode for that is worth checking out and investing in, and you can play it pretty quickly. And then the only new game I've got is Time Stories Revolutions, which we've done Time Stories on a podcast before. Those were the old white box ones where you had to have like the main game, and then you bought the expansions that were like stories that you like you put in the VCR to do that. And this one, these are standalone. This is their blue box thing. And there's so far there's two of them. We played through one, and there's a little experience box that helps you like link them together. And there's a third one coming out. After playing the first one, I don't know that I'm gonna open the second one.
Oof.
The things I liked about Time Stories the most was the puzzles. Wasn't really feeling that. There's a new system about how you manage the time. Instead of using time, you use these crystals. I think it's kind of hard to manage. I don't know. Just something didn't click with it. I loved Time Stories so much, but I cannot recommend this new blue box.
My recommendation is that you play the second one, and if it sucks, you go back in time and then unplay it.
Okay, sounds good.
Get your life back.
Maybe the second one's better. I don't know. And I don't know. But I mean, Bo had fun with it. I just didn't. I mean, maybe we needed to play it all in one sitting. We kind of played it in a couple of sittings, and I think it lost something between there.
How long are the scenarios?
I mean, I think you can probably play it in under 2 hours.
Still pretty long for
but
Bo.
But it was pretty long for him. Well, in that and. A lot of times you're playing it at night, and like it's not that he wouldn't have sat there the whole time and played it, because if he likes something, his attention span is that long. But you know, if it's like school night or something, it's like, well, we got to stop now, and they do have, because Time Stories does come in. Here's deck one, here's deck two, and you know what, they do have a really cool, like the new item system is cool. There's a lot of cool things to like about it. I just think like Chronicles of Crime does that kind of thing better now than Time Stories is doing. I think they could probably do some more interesting things with it. We'll see. The new scenario that's coming out, though, is like a haunted house one that looks kind of cool. And I'm curious. We have not looked at the experience part that kind of lets you build your character as you go throughout the different stories, which I think might be neat. So maybe we need to run through that. Now that we finished the first one, you know what? I'll play the second one and I'll come back and tell you if it got any better.
Boxes being opened.
Yeah.
I mean, it's all replayable, right? So I can always just throw it all together in a bundle on a sale pile somewhere down the road. But anyway, disappointed. But
can I just
we'll
make
see.
my yearly petition to the people who are making these types of games where you have to go figure out what happened in this mystery? If you guys don't put out a Carmen Sandiego themed one of these things, could you at least just... I'll meet you halfway. Could you at least just do DuckTales? That's all I got. But Carmen Sandiego, I just want to reiterate, would be much better.
You guys
are Carmen Sandiego fans,
yeah,
right?
You got to have the music for sure.
Yeah. Recently, the dudes who wrote that song re-recorded it in like 5 different styles. There's like, if you go to Spotify, there's the original like boo wop bow where she sneaks around, and then they did like a funk version and like a pop version and like a disco version. They all kind of sound the same. It's kind of like when you get like a new phone and it has the same like one song, but they do it in like 70 different ways. You know what I'm talking about?
Yeah.
I don't know if Apple does that, but Samsung does that every single time.
Jake's too young for Carmen Sandiego.
Are you too young for Where in the World?
I definitely remember Carmen Sandiego.
Oh my gosh,
really
the acting on that, like the woman who played the chief was so cool, and the host seemed like a really fun guy. And then I don't know if you guys know this, but Rockapella, those weirdos, those guys basically made up all their little interstitials. Like, they'd be like, hey, we're doing an episode about the Congo today. And then they'd, like, those five dudes with, like, the goofy hair would have to be like, how are we going to acapella our five different little skits in the center of this thing? And not only the theme song, which is insane, but they also did that other song that was like, be wow, 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 wow. I'm a big, and I haven't watched an episode of this show in probably 25 years. I just remember it like the like it was yesterday. Anyway, I'll probably cut all that out.
Right on. All right.
not the part where I ask the power, where I ask Rob Davio to make a Carmen Sandiego game. Rob Davio, do it, please. As a favor.
Tim, what have you been playing?
All right. I got two this week. Let's see. I got Atiwa. Atiwa? Atiwa?
Atiwa, I think,
Atiwa?
Right?
Atiwa? I got Atiwa to the Atiwa. Table. It's a Uwe Rosenberg worker placement game. I'm not going to get super into it because I believe we will probably play it on this podcast here.
I'd like to for sure.
Shortly. It was very good. I liked it a lot. And it had a nice like loop to it where you're, I don't know, getting animals to make trees to make fruit to get bats, and the bats eat the fruit and make trees again. It's quite a satisfying loop, and it was very fun. The second one I got to the table was Terracotta Army. No one else here has played that?
No.
Okay.
We missed out on that at BGG Con.
Yeah, it is a very tight worker placement game that uses like smaller and larger workers to kind of activate the same spots. If you have a larger worker, you can activate over a smaller worker. It was very tight. It was very cool. The scoring was obnoxious, especially at the end of the game.
Yeah, I've heard endgame scoring is...
Yeah, what's a group? What's not a group? What dominates the group? What doesn't dominate a group? How do you score when you're dominated in some... I don't know.
I could figure that out. I'm really smart.
Yeah. It was a lot to go through, and just catching all the pieces that needed to score was tough, but... it was a fun game. It was definitely probably, for me, about a two-boinger, I think. I don't think we'll probably do it on the podcast, but it was fun. I would definitely check it out. Jake, what do you got?
I got two things. I'm going to talk about them in complexity order, so from light to higher. I played Archduke, which is a card game. It reminds me a lot of the card game Golf, if you remember what that game is.
Yeah, I love Golf. Fun.
So wait, real quick. Golf, do you play with four cards or six cards?
I feel like five cards, three in the middle and two on the ends.
You play golf different. I play with four.
Yeah, two on top, two on the bottom, or three on top, three. Like,
I always play with two, and you could look at two, and you couldn't look at the other
right.
two.
Yeah.
So that is like Archduke, but I did golf with three in the middle and two on the ends. And then if you got – anyways, I think there's a lot of different ways to play that game apparently. But in this game, you have four cards. You like what Tim and Cam just mentioned. You can look at two of them and not the others. The thing that makes it a little bit interesting is there's a deck that you are going to flip a card over, and it'll be face up. And if ever you have a match of that card, you can instantly dump it. And then you have less cards to work with. And so when you feel like you have the smallest amount of cards available, then you say Archduke, and everybody else gets one more turn. But there are also cards that have abilities that when you play them from the pile in front of you out, like you discard it, then it lets you do something. So you can swap somebody's cards. You can give a card to somebody else. There's a lot of things that kind of change that. It's interesting because to some extent you want to keep higher cards, even though you want to have as low of a score as possible. Because then when somebody dumps it, then you can match those out to get rid of cards. There's also two cards that are worth -3.
If someone that is not next to you dumps a card, you can match it?
Everybody can across the table. Okay. Yep, and just have to have it done by the time somebody else draws a card. So it plays up to six. You play four rounds, and then you want to have the lowest number possible, and each you basically look at your order for whoever has the least amount of points, and they get a one-point token all the way up to the person who has the most gets the point token that matches the number of players that there were. It is designed by Ryan Tibbetts, and it is from Navigator Creative. It's really cheap. It is really flexible in who you can play it with. I played it with my family, and we played multiple games in a row, and everybody seemed to really enjoy it. I have played that game probably four or five times now, and I have never not gotten last. So not a game I'm good at, but I think it's fun. So I would recommend that one. Archduke.
Is it about Franz Ferdinand?
There seems to be nothing about Franz Ferdinand. I think the theme, which is just purely in what's on the colors, is you're traveling across a desert. I feel like there's more about why that is the way it is in the rule book, but I don't remember that part.
Is it embarrassing where when Franz Ferdinand is the only archduke you know, or is it more embarrassing if you don't know any archdukes? Because I almost think it would be less bad than not even know any of any archdukes besides just the most, like the Coca-Cola of archdukes.
Well, I mean, certainly not every country had like the position of an archduke, though, so I don't think it's embarrassing to only know Franz Ferdinand. I used to, when I taught U.S. history and we would do our World War I test, I would always wear my Franz Ferdinand the Band shirt, except it's like the mirror image because that's what their logo was. Mm. I don't know that it helped anybody, but I always felt good about it. Okay, the second game I want to talk about is Hickory Dickory. It is by Sawyer West, and it is actually his first game that he's designed, and it's by Plaid Hat Games, which I've only played Dead of Winter from Plaid Hat.
I mean, this is cool. Like in the Mice of Mystics universe, right?
Oh, is it?
I mean, it's based on like the fairy tale, but it's mice. So, I mean, there's a lot of...
They do a lot of mice games.
Okay, well then,
Mice of Mystics was cool. I played that once or twice.
So, this game is... It is incredibly thematic for those of you who care about it, but it is a big clock in the middle of the board, and your mice, they are on different action spaces for each of the hours, and when they're on an action space, you can either jump to the outside ring to perform the action there and click a tile that it's a set collection, or you can jump on the hand of the clock, which is going to move from places. And so, whenever the clock moves, the mice that are on the clock, whoever's the closest to the end... That's the priority for when you jump out. And so the first person to take that action gets the tile. Nobody else does. But I think the thing that makes it really interesting is when more mice jump on, there's only room for X amount of mice, depending on how many players you're playing with, and it'll push mice off. So you might want to get further to get to better actions, especially where you can deliver your products, which is how you get most of your points. But you have to kind of math out how many people are in front of you and what they're going to do to decide if you can actually stay on the clock or not. So that's kind of cool. You can also exchange the tiles between the mice that are in the same place. So you want to kind of link them up to be able to hand them off to people who can score more. The thing that I think it's really interesting and thematic, and it's a lot deeper of a thought than maybe it would be when you look at it. I think it has some scaling issues because you literally do nothing different from 2 to 4 players except determine how many people can be on the clock. And so... anytime something is taken, it does not get replaced. And with 4 players, those things go really fast. And maybe that's the point, but it definitely means with more players, you score way less points. But it's interesting. It's certainly more of a think than I thought it was. It says 10 plus, and I think that's for age. And I think that's probably accurate. There's nothing that's too complicated about the game, the way it works. Just, you know, how you're going to maximize your decisions.
Yeah, I was wondering if it was good for kids or not.
I think it would be. Essentially, you're just, you can kind of see what you're going to score, and you score based on the number of tiles you turn in, what colors match, and what symbols match. So
it's interesting. I literally saw this today at Dungeons Gate, and it's like, oh, it's mice and Plaid Hat Games. I'm like, I figured it had something to do with Mice Mystics.
Yeah.
I was like, this must be some kind of clock dungeon crawl.
It is a clock. There's no dungeon crawl to it, but it's, the little market is Itsy Bitsy's, like market. So there's a lot of like fairy tales tucked in, but I played it on Tuesday, and everybody seemed to like it. So I recommend it. It's fun.
It looked... the components are looking...
They look really nice. Yeah, the clock really component in the middle is really, really cool.
Yeah. The art's really great.
Mm-hmm. And like the tiles are like Azul tiles, so they're, they're a nice feel to them.
Cam, what you got?
I haven't really played a lot new to me in the last couple weeks. I missed the last couple gaming days. I am playing a game, an Uwe Rosenberg game with you guys online right now called Applejack. That I think is actually really cool. I don't know how you guys are feeling about that.
I literally have no idea how to play.
I know how to play, and it just feels weird that all the time you're just hoping to break even with the amount of money you spend.
No, that's not it at all.
I mean, well, no, if you can line up to where you're getting big, but I mean, how many times are you going to do that?
That's maybe you don't know this. What about the scoring part?
Well, sure. Like you get your apples, but when you take the tile, you're matching. You get the lower number of whatever it lines up to. So when you take one, the best you can do is break even, unless it hits multiple. I'm not talking about any of the harvests that come from the apples themselves.
Sure.
As you cross stuff, but just when you take a tile, you're hoping to break even. It also seems weird that you can take a blind one and not know how much you have to pay.
I've never taken a blind one.
I have, and it's weird.
That is kind of weird. Like I'm not saying it's perfect. I think there's a couple things cool about it. One is, so it's a game that kind of is like a lot of his other puzzle games. Like if you know how Uwe designs games, it makes a lot of sense. But what you're trying to do is you're trying to put these hexes on the board. I'm guessing the game is set up so that you fill all the hexes by the end of the game. But basically, they all have apples in the center, and they all have like these little beehives on the side, and the beehives have numbers on them. And you pay, however many dollars or like honey in the game is the number of the beehives, and then you put it on the board, and if you connect a beehive up to another beehive via the grid, you get the number of honey back from the smaller beehive. So, yes, one of the ways you gain points in the game is by connecting, like, two beehives, like, on multiple beehives on different sides on the same turn, and hope you get, like, a lot of honey from it. The other way you get points is by making groups of apples on the board, and every once in a while you score each of the apples twice per revolution of the game. The game revolves three times, and then you score all the apples one more time. And you get diminishing returns by a little bit for the apples, like the apple groups. I think it's a good escalation because it diminishes by a point per group for each of the three rounds. And so, like, if you're not continuing to build, like, what you get off the top, it gets shaved pretty bad. What Jake is saying is he doesn't understand, like, I think it works great because, like, we're all near the end of the game and we all have, like, more than enough money than we'd ever need. So at the end of the game, I think you're either choosing whether to make bigger groups or if you're going to try to set up some cool combo wombos. Cause, like, there have been a couple times when I've gotten, like, 20 points for placing a hexagon, but there's also times where I've, like, added a bunch of apples to one group and I know I'm going to get to score it three more times. But also, one thing I didn't mention is there's flowers, too. And if you have a bunch of flowers on your board, when you score, you get a bazillion points that way, too. So, I don't know. I think it's cool. I don't think it's, like, his coolest design. But I think if I was an Uwe super fan, it would rank higher in my list of his puzzle games than most of them. Because a lot of them are kind of, like, less good versions of Patchwork. Or like
I like Nova Luna quite a bit.
Nova Luna would be... I would say for his puzzle series, I am... I don't know if I'd count New York Zoo quite as a puzzle, like the puzzle game. So I think I would be Patchwork, Nova Luna, Applejack from what I've played so far. So I think it's pretty good.
Yeah, I don't think it's as good as Patchwork for sure. But it's been entertaining.
That's hard to be as good as Patchwork. Patchwork is one of the very, very good game.
Speaking of Patchwork, I saw that he has a new game called Stack and Stuff, a Patchwork game. And I'm curious, I saw this at Dungeons Gate tonight as well. Is it really just Patchwork? I don't know.
Is it called Stackin' Stuff or I mean, Stack and Stuff?
Stackin' Stuff.
It's in the same universe, is what you're saying.
I still don't know what it's called. Is it called Stack and Stuff?
No, in.
Stackin' Stuff. Like I'm stacking
like,
stuff.
Like an N. You're basically stacking
stack
stuff.
Stuff.
Yeah, like in a.
So it's like Stack and Stuff.
Like in a packing truck.
Yeah.
The description says it's a streamlined version of Patchwork.
Stacking stuff in a packing truck.
Like, what can be more streamlined with Patchwork?
I don't know. They apparently streamlined into Patchwork Express, yeah, but which I'm not sure what that ended up being.
Neither of those are that different than
Patchwork Express was a doodle game though, right?
Patchwork Doodle.
Yeah, it's a re-theme of Patchwork Express, which means that it has some easier pieces, a slightly smaller board, and a special rule which adds filler pieces at some point in the game to make it easier to fill up your board more effectively. That's what it says.
So
I guess it's a retooling of Patchwork Express, which I never understood why they needed that to begin with.
Which makes it even easier.
I mean, I kind of like the theme of stacking stuff in a moving truck. Yeah, plus, if you see the board, it's got a picture of Uwe with his head out the side of the truck going like, hey.
Can
you?
So these old dopey German guys know how funny they are now, right? Because Stefan Feld's putting pictures of himself on games too now.
Yeah. It's the best.
Sorry for steamrolling you there,
but
Tim.
You don't actually stack things in three dimensions. You just put them on the board.
Yeah, like, look.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But look, there he is. In the truck.
He looks good.
We should post that on Instagram.
Yeah, I will. Look at
Uwe.
That guy.
Ooh wee.
All right. That's what we've been playing?
Yeah.
Should we talk about the feature review?
Sure.
Let's do it.
Oh, yeah, can I say one thing really fast? I'm really late to the party, but I finally played some of the tutorials of the Gloomhaven app, and it's way fun.
Yeah, I've heard it's really good.
So if you guys got it for free during Epic Game Sale, dust it off like I did. Oh, I think me and Dre are going to try to play it next Wednesday. That's after the podcast comes out, or before the podcast comes out, though. So I guess you guys can't join us for that one.
Not useful.
Yeah, sorry, not useful. But if any of you three want to join us for it.
But go check out the Discord. They talk about it on there. It's been kind of light lately. the chatter anyway.
I had a very busy week.
I think a lot of people have been busy lately.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway, tonight on the podcast, we played Oak. It is from 2022, a whole year ago, or maybe just 2 months ago.
I mean, it was pretty late in 2022.
Oak is 1 to 4 players, best 2 to 3, ages 14 plus, 60 to 90 minutes, weight 3.15. Designer, Wim Goosens. Love that guy. Artist, Masij Janik. And publisher, Game Brewer. I'm just going to come out and tell you, its overall rank is 3,286 currently. And, I mean, it's only got 538 ratings and 167 comments, which is kind of strange because this was a pretty decent Kickstarter, I think. But it is what it is. Jake, why don't you tell us what we're doing? Oh, sorry, it's good for right now. It's a 7.4 on BGG for the rating scale. Jake, why don't you tell us what we're doing in Oak?
So we are different druid orders, and we are essentially trying to prove our worth to the big oak tree. So you are going to take your faction, which has different abilities, which definitely they push you in the direction of what your druid faction does best, which I think is kind of neat, and there are a lot of different avenues to pursue there. But you are sending your workers out to take actions that represent the three different resources that you spend throughout the game, which are feathers, mistletoe, and runes. And other than that, you are working your way up a tree, which is scoring you points and also working you towards the big scoring components in the certain directions that you went into. That's probably pretty brief.
All right, well, we'll dig into that more as we go. Why don't we tie one around the old oak tree and we'll be back.
Like a yellow ribbon, like from the song.
Yeah.
Yeah. And we'll be back.
That's a great lead-in, Campbell, to the song you're going to play right now.
How hilarious would it be if I didn't do that song?
And you won't.
I might.
Just because that's a camp thing to do, just to spite me.
I actually...
For doing the obvious
thing. I actually very rarely spite you.
I think you spite me more often than you think. Talk about our initial thoughts of OAK. Oak?
I'll go first, since I played it first. I remember the first time I played this, and I said this on the podcast last season, but it's just so weird. Like, it's unique. There's so many things in it I feel like are just different than other games that I've played, and so that really stood out to me the first time that I played it.
Yeah, for me, it looks nice. It's not too overwhelming when you got it out. It didn't feel like this, like, oh, I got it. There's a lot of stuff going on here. So it looks really nice. It looks like it can, like, it seemed to learn pretty easily. And the rules teach was not super long, 10 minutes maybe, max. And it was good.
I think, as I've said this before, I've been a pretty big fan of Game Brewer in the past. And their last couple of games were misses for me. So when I saw this one on Kickstarter originally, I was like, I'm going to pass on it. Some wild druid people out.
What were the misses?
Hippocrates and Stroganoff just fine. So I just kind of passed on this one. But then as soon as I saw it came with, like, cool stuff, you get to jack your guys out on and, like...
You what?
You get to equip them with stuff. You get to jack them out.
Okay.
Dude... I've been ill for like 5 days.
Bro, you're still ill.
My brain does not work properly.
You know,
I think deck them out was the yeah. the word I was looking for.
I think that's the word you were looking for too. I think that I just got my first look at the box art, which I think is really beautiful. I'd be really excited about to look at the back of this box if I saw it on the shelf. We can come back to that. I'm still kind of working out how I feel about this game, which is really not rare for a game I played the first time on the podcast and like kind of dissecting my feelings. So I don't think it's about to get a negative review from me, but I think that aspects of this game, my initial impression were aspects of this game as I was playing it seemed really, like Jake said, unique, but a lot of it felt pretty samey to other worker placement, kind of multifaceted games I've played. And I'm going to do my best to think of what I'd compare some of the facets to. And so we'll get into pros and cons here, I think. And I definitely had a good time playing it for the first time. We'll say that, though. That'll be my starting point.
Can I go with the first pro?
Yeah.
You deck your workers out with awesome little plastic pieces.
Really?
That, like,
I whacked mine
yeah,
out.
Yeah, yeah. You deck them out. I'm just going to say it. And it's really cool. Like, that's a cool thing. It doesn't have really... I guess there's a little bit of gameplay function to it, but you could accomplish that in a bunch of different other ways. And it, I don't know, it's just fun. It makes it cool. It makes you want to go get those guys and, you know.
Yeah, one of the only other games that I can think of that really has that is Viticulture, with one of the expansions adds in special meeples that have special powers. And those are all screen printed.
They're different.
Yeah. One of the Tiny Epic games has... I think it's like Tiny Epic Heroes, I think is
yeah, you can give
Tiny
them like
Epic
swords
quest.
And shields and
yeah,
stuff.
Yeah, like little holes where you can like press in like these little plastic swords and shields that look really cool. But I think all those really do, like, they're all functionally identical. Like, all they're just like the builds are different, I think. If I remember right, it's been a long time since I played that. But it kind of reminded me of that. I think they did a better... obviously, this is a big game, and Tiny Epic's whole thing is like...
Or small.
Yeah, and I think Tiny Epic fires on all cylinders when they're simple. I think every Tiny Epic game that tried to get, like, overcomplicated, like Western, I think, was the worst of them, like, just wasn't fun because it's like you're trying to play this big game with, like, tweezers. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So, cool idea from Quest, cool idea from Oak.
Yeah, and they're all, like, a little bit different sculpts for each different kind of upgraded druid. And they all fit in there pretty nicely, and... I don't know, they just make them look cool.
And the thematics of what like the reason each one can have the ability it has, I think works pretty well. I don't understand why the bard gives you extra space, but all the rest of them I think work pretty good.
He's telling a story of a distant land that had more, I don't know.
I guess that could be.
There might be an explanation in there.
I think they just wanted to make a loot, but they couldn't figure out what a bard would do.
That's certainly possible. I think one of my favorite things about the game is every time you flip out new artifacts or you flip out new creature cards and you read what they are, it's just like everything just seems so good, especially if you can synergize what it is that you're taking. So like I had an upgraded card that let me move on any tree branch for just one of the resources, but then I also got a card that let me take a feather action and then just move for one more. And so those two together let me move two things for a total of two resources, which normally it's six to do that. So, and two actions. So, I don't know. I just think it's really neat that everything seems awesome and makes you want to try that in the future.
Yeah.
It feels like everybody can everybody, at least in this game, focused on something that was a little bit different. And we all still ended up generally around the same number of points, plus or minus, what, 10 maybe?
Well, that's because
I was pretty far behind you guys, but I was an outlier. Yeah. I don't think I executed.
We all have different player boards that like all gave us different free type actions, which pointed us in different things. So mine was building those extra huts, and yours was getting the animal cards or whatever.
It is true. I didn't really like mine gave me a bunch of extra stuff, but it didn't really point me in a direction.
Right.
Yeah. So for a first play, like it was, I think my guys were like easier to never like be poor. Because I got like extra resources, but I think it did have an effect on like what I was going for.
Yeah, but it feels like you could do any of the four or five different facets of the game and still be competitive. It didn't feel like one was less important than the other, yep, and they're all broken.
Yep, and even though your board is pushing you one way, you know, there are essentially three different major branches of the tree, and you're probably trying to get to the end of those tracks, so you still got to choose at least two different right. ways to complement what it is that your main board was doing for you.
Yeah. Part of me thinks that, and this is not pro talk, but part of me thinks that maybe the... I don't know, maybe you always go for all three, like, as the game, as you play more times, but I sort of think maybe it'd be you really try to tank two of them and get tons of points, because you give up a lot of actions to press all three trees.
That's definitely true, but also, though, you know, in the ways that you're going up the trees, you still have a fork that you need to choose, so even if you don't necessarily go, I mean, but you still get some options, I guess, with where you're going to go. Mm-hmm. I guess what could run you poor or what could hurt you in this game is if you're pushing two paths and it makes you diverge and you can only do one of them. So
yeah.
You got to kind of be cognizant of what you're giving up to score the one that you're going to score better.
It does kind of hurt, like, when if you want to, like, do two of the things that are on the same limb of the tree in different branches. But I don't know. I don't think that's a bad thing.
Yeah, I mean, that was a tough thing for me this game. And I think it gave you some tough choices. So every card, you have three different actions you can do on the card. Well, four. Three of them take a worker. One of them doesn't. The one just pushes you up one of the tree branches. The other three do different things in the game. And the three things on one card are completely different than the three things on the other card, and they're completely different than the three things on the other card. But you only have one of the cards, so every time you're like, I can only do one of these three. I can do one of these three, one of these three. And like I'd rather do all three of these on these cards and not do either of these on these cards. But you can't do that, except for if you go get more cards, because all the other cards kind of mix match and they make everything cheaper, the actions you do. So the card action is pretty powerful just to give you more options. Not only that, but to make things cheaper. So... it took me a little while to wrap my head around that, but I ended up coming around and liking it.
It kind of reminds me of, like, the flow of the game kind of reminds me of Wingspan, in that, like, in Wingspan, you need to spend extra eggs to get, like, to boost the amount of food you're getting, and you need to spend extra food to boost the amount of cards you're getting, and you need to spend a card to, like, make one extra egg, like, as you're building your engine. And this is a lot of, like, I want to upgrade a guy, but I need a space that can hold an upgraded guy. And now once I have this guy, like, I need some other regular guys, but I need to give up a guy to go get a couple more guys. And, like, there's kind of this loop of you have to wait to, like, upgrade. Like, you can't, like, tank out one strategy because everything's kind of, like, you're held to the limit. Like, if you get a ton of cards but you don't have the guys to use them, you need more guys. If you get a ton of guys, you don't have cards, and what are they there for? If you don't have places to hold the guys, what's the point of getting the guys? And so you kind of have to, like, build everything out, and that's not a bad thing in a game, because I think so many Euro games are more like centered around, like, choosing a couple avenues and doing really well, whereas I think this one is kind of more about, like, building smart. So I think that was a cool thing about it, because you're always kind of thinking about how can I increase my efficiency on the whole.
But you can definitely avoid things, though. If you think about, like, neither Rob nor Tim took any artifacts. That's something that we just both did. I mean, there are definitely components you could just flat ignore, because it's just not in the way that your cards and your workers are aligning to be able to, you know, proceed.
But those aren't really your core points, you know?
Well,
like,
sure they are. I mean, if you can get three different artifacts and get the points for the artifacts and flip the artifact thing at the end of the like, that's a ton of points. Or if you're just, you know, the first time I played this, I just did nothing but potions. I had no creatures. I had no artifacts. I didn't expand to have any more people, but I was brewing that 7-point, you know, five different resources, like, every round.
Sure, sure. I guess the analogy, though, is, like, you can play a game of Wingspan where you have 7 bonus cards. You can play
sure.
a game, like, the core loop of, like, dudes, upgrades, tree, and, like, extra cards. I think those things, like, you kind of all go hand in hand, and you can't really like push one super hard without like growing the others. But I think the fun things to explore in that then is the animals and the artifacts and the potions, which all actually, that's a huge pro because those are all really cool. And there's like a big deck of animals and artifacts you can do. And I take it there's other potions.
Mm-hmm. Way more potions.
So, yeah, those parts are cool.
The choices between, so on your cards, you can either use it to move up a tree or you can use it to do one of three actions. And usually those reactions are pretty good. And I couldn't really tell exactly how they lined up, but the end game scorings, were they in alignment with what the cards were doing too? It kind of felt like they were a little
bit. I think so. It was definitely the, well, maybe not, because it was mistletoe card that upgraded your people, and mistletoe was on the feather track. So I don't know that it does necessarily.
There might be some opposites there. Choosing when to use a card to go up the tree or when to use it for an action was quite interesting, and it made it more complicated to think about and to strategize on what you wanted to do, because you want to take the action on the card, but you also want to move up that tree. And what's more important? What's going to get me more points? What's better for my game right now? I thought was really an interesting interaction.
I think another thing that is neat about the tree component is when you reach the end of each branch, you score it immediately. So if this was just a game where you get all your points at the end of the game, then yep, obviously I want to get there and I want to lean into that. But to some extent, there is a push and pull of how fast do I want to move up that tree branch? Because if I can get there in a turn that nobody else can, I'm the only one that can score that. And so even if I'm not getting as many points as I could, it prevents anybody else from potentially getting those. Now, none of us really did that this game. No branch was closed until the fourth round, and nobody got left out of it, and every other branch was closed in the last round. But I think there is a way to play this where you might be some of the only ones that get to those points. Right. And I think that's interesting because you naturally want to score more from it, but it may not be in your best interest to do that. And I think that's kind of interesting element. And I also really like with the artifacts, when you take them, you get an influx of points, and those actions are really good, but every time you take that action, it ends up taking points away from you, to the point where if you use it the three times that it allows, you end up losing points from that, but then you got those actions. So I think that's kind of an interesting dynamic as well.
Sometimes losing points is good.
Yes.
Because when you, there at certain points in time, there's a marker that moves, basically once at the end of the round, and then when you move your people up the tree a little bit, and then once it gets to a certain point, you do tree income, I guess what it would be. But if you have more points than where the marker is at, you don't get the income, which I thought was interesting. So holding off on scoring points to try to get income is another thing you need to think about and deal with.
There's a variant in the rule book that says if you want a more challenging game, if you are further than the festival marker, you actually have to pay those resources when the harvest happens. So kind of an idea of giving to the people that are less fortunate. But I think that's interesting. That would give you obviously even more of an incentive to not push up your track of scoring too fast. But
I mean, there were certainly times where I did not score points. I think Cam, you did the same thing. You just didn't score points to get the, I don't know that was actually worth it, but I made a conscious decision not to score points.
Yeah, I made a conscious one time. I do think that the artifacts were maybe like the coolest thing in the game for me, because like thinking back to like what really made me feel like I was doing something fun was the like near like the halfway point of the game, like deciding whether or not that round if I was going to use those powers, and like how many times more times I was planning on doing it. And there was one that I was even planning on running all the way out, but then I was like, the weight of whether or not it was worth 3 points to take that action, as I started to see like the end game scoring shape, was I think really meaningful. And so I like the artifacts. I didn't get to mess around with the animals, so I never really know what those did. They seemed like they had kind of similar functions. Like the animals kind of gave like passive abilities, right? And the artifacts gave like active abilities that were really powerful.
Yeah, I would think the animals were just a little bit less powerful. They did some weird things. They were worth a little less points, but you didn't lose any points either. So,
I think if I play this game again, I would always be attracted to like the artifacts over the animals for that reason, because like the artifacts were really cool to mess around with. But maybe I'd have fun with the animals.
Again, to your point with the cards and the people, like if you get artifacts, you have to get more druids on your board to be able to activate the artifacts and still use your cards. And
but you don't with the animals. I don't know.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I had three workers for most of the game.
The extra cards were interesting because they like they really mixed up the like how you could take the actions. That was one of the most frustrating things at the beginning of the game, was like not being able to take two of the actions I wanted to take in a round because I just didn't have a way to do it. Because
they're on the same card.
Mm-hmm.
Grr.
I like that the upgrade cards weren't just cheaper like ways to do the same action, but like it actually kind of helped you. It kind of helped you in like a couple of areas because
I didn't actually do them like on
you didn't have a single updated card,
just the big one.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. But the big one would be out like a separate one that's only from the potion. So yep. Yeah.
So it's not in every game.
Not in every game. Yeah.
But like the it's not just cheaper of the same action. There's actually different actions on those cards, right?
Yes, different actions.
Yeah, that's cool.
So I guess that's another pro. I mean, there's lots of replayability here, I think. There's lots of... You only play with so many potions. Those change. What else
I think there's at least six different potions for each number. It tells you to put 1-1, 1-2, and 1-3 out there.
Oh, okay.
So there's a big difference. And then, obviously, what did we see? A third of the animal deck, and we probably saw half of the artifacts that came out. So
yeah.
There's a lot of variability. Plus, some of the potions just bring things into the game that aren't normally there. So, like, we had better moot cards, which is I was the only one that didn't get. There's a different one that lets you get an upgraded druid that can be any of the druids, which is pretty cool. And there's another one that lets you get a third artifact. So it gives you an extension to put that in there. Mm. So there is, you know, definitely components come in that aren't even regularly in the game through the different potions, which is pretty cool.
Hey, here's a question. Is there, like, little pieces of cardboard to randomize the ends of the tree? Like the scoring on the tree?
There aren't, but that would be interesting.
Yeah, I think I would house make some of those because... To me, I think it would get boring with the tree being the same every time. And I think all it would take for me to have more fun with it is just randomizing the branches so that you could, like, you actually could mess around with different scoring opportunities than the basic one that's given to you every single game. So, and I'm not saying I would create any extra ones, like new scoring objectives, although I don't see why you couldn't have different ones that went in there. But, I wish that was there. That's an opportunity for the Oak expansion. Oak expansion. Lil' Acorn.
Anybody more else? Trees and creatures.
Yeah.
Anybody else got another pro? Any prawns? Weirdness?
Yeah, here's a prawn. I almost never have a prawn. I don't think that the box art matches up with the gameplay at all. I think the box art's awesome. I think the gameplay is really good, too. I would have never guessed that the box art of this game looked like this after playing it.
I mean, it's a bunch of people standing at the roots of a tree, which is where you had six people.
Yeah, but look
at,
like, they're holding these things. Like, this isn't a part of the game at all right here. And, like, these dudes are very, like, I just didn't get that. I didn't get this vibe from it. I got a different vibe from the gameplay. But, like, tons of games do that, and I don't think it's a problem. There's been so many games where, like, they have terrible box art and awesome gameplay and beautiful box art and terrible gameplay. This is good gameplay and good box art. I just don't think they match. Prawn, for me.
I don't have a prawn at all. Have we got a con?
Yeah, I got plenty.
Hit them up.
I'm trying to remember what they were. I don't know if I have plenty. I have a couple.
I guess I got one, at least one to start with. When you start, if you don't necessarily have a firm direction of where to go, you don't get a lot of resources back each round. So, and because some of the better actions that are, you know, the three stone ones, which require basically all that you start with, you can dig yourself in a pretty big hole from spending all your resources and just not being able to get them back and then not having a great way to get out of that right away without getting to the higher in the tree and waiting for those income phases to come in. So I think it's definitely a game that you would benefit from kind of having a clear plan of what you were hoping to do. And so I guess that kind of lends itself to maybe somebody who's played it before. Although, obviously, I'd played this game multiple times. I didn't win, and nobody else had. So, but I think just the decisions you make at first can be pretty impactful on the rest of your game and maybe to more of an extent than is ideal.
It might end up being a benefit for me, but I think we were actually supposed to draft the starting thing.
Based opposite of starting player.
Yeah, there's not much of a benefit for people that are going, you know, second, third, fourth. So getting the worker placement spot that you wanted is a little harder. So I think Rob and I, which were third and fourth player, like I didn't even get to use a worker in the first round. I just couldn't use them, which felt a little bad, but I think it ended up, to your point, letting me have more resources that I could use in the other rounds, which at the time I was like, yeah, this, you know, this sucks. I don't have anything I can do with this guy, but you know, might have been a benefit at the end, you know, towards the end of the game. I don't know how you felt about being last, but
I mean, the first round didn't feel good.
Yeah.
But it, there's lots of games like that. It kind of is what it is. I'm not sure that I dig the worker placement with the cards thing. I mean, I already said that I liked that, but I also didn't like that. And then some rounds you just have guys you can't use, and sometimes you have cards you can't use. Or
it felt kind of arbitrary and like a little bit punishing.
Yeah, it just didn't fully. The game loop just didn't grab me really. I mean, I can't really put my mind on like any hard cons.
I'm with you that that was probably my least favorite aspect of the game. I wouldn't say I disliked it, but it's just like, this doesn't bring me joy, and like it's not like a cool puzzle.
Yeah, like I'd like to either be able to know I'm gonna do it or not do it, kind of a thing.
Here's my con. I'm remembering what it was. I really only have one like pretty major gripe about this game, and I thought that like the potion making thing in the game was really cool. But I think it sucks that one of your like main actions of the round can go like to grab a like a potion thing like from a bag. Like you're giving up one of your dudes to do it. You're giving up one of your cards to do it. You're paying like at least a third of your resources of a type to go and reach into a bag and maybe pull out a thing that isn't even in one of the potions. Like you can save it up for the points potion. Maybe you're trying to build a different one. I don't understand why you can't just choose one of the things off the board and replace it. I think that would have made potions way more exciting. There were so many times during the game I was like, oh, I want to go get like reagents and make a potion. But like, who knows if I'll even get what I need for the potion I'm trying to build. But I see like four of them right there. Like, why can't I take one and then replace it? I don't understand the action economy. It seemed really lopsided.
Well, I mean, there's also, you know, animal cards that let you just pick whatever you wanted when you did that. There's other animal cards that let you pull from those things when you did different actions, you know, and there are also artifacts that allow you to do things with resources or ingredients as well. So I guess that's a counter, but we didn't mention this earlier, but I also think it's interesting that the first person that passes gets the first choice of what ingredients are there. So, you know, most worker placement games encourage you to last a long time. If you think of, I guess, like Everdell comes to mind in that generally you want to stick around as long as you can in a season, so you are, you know, you're getting more out of that than other people. Whereas this, you, if you're brewing potions, you probably want to have quick actions pass, get your ingredients that way, and then it's not even something you're doing with a turn. So I agree that action's not great, but I also would, I guess, say that the one feather action of sliding a counter is probably not that great either. So, but then I guess the one action rune is pulling people back, which did get used quite a bit. So,
yeah.
But I'm there might be some balance in the way that they put those in, but.
I agree with everything you're saying. It still just felt like completely worthless. But that was my first play of the game, and I think a lot of people complain about like card draw in games where like I play it a few times and I go, that's not really an issue. So it could be not an issue at all. Maybe like if I was trying to make potions, I would just be passing earlier and then getting the stuff I wanted there. Because if you pass a couple times, you could like that could get you a potion.
Yeah, well, the first time I played this, I was the potion faction, and I think I was the first to pass every single round, and I would get, I mean, basically, if I was able to score that, so I was able to do it, I had the druid that lets you brew in potions with one less, so I only needed four different ingredients, and so I just would pass early, get those, draw from the bag with my action, and then do that potion again. So, I mean, I think you can lean in that way, but I guess, you know, I never took that action of drawing out of the bag, but potions just isn't something that I did this game, so sure, I can feel that.
I chose not to three rounds in a row because I didn't want to get something I couldn't use.
Economy around the ingredients seems a little bit weird because on the board you can spend two ingredients for like one resource, I guess. Like, ingredients are hard to get.
It's one of each, I think.
I think it's just.
I said one of each in the beginning, but when we looked up that on something else later, it was one. So,
only one.
Yeah,
total?
That seems real bad. But
that seems like hot garbage.
But right. If you're just not brewing potions, what do you need ingredients for?
Is that the horrible nugget of the
game? But by the end of the game, if you just kept your one ingredient, you would score 5 to 7 points or whatever.
Potentially, you got different ones. If you're always getting the same one, then that doesn't help
you. In order to spend those two, you would have to get at least 3 points out of that one resource to make it even close to worth it. Yeah.
Well, it is kind of like a consolation to the person who's collecting ingredients who doesn't want to make a single potion.
Right. Or, but, you know, we had potions where if you had the right two ingredients, you could go get 9 resources instead of 1.
Right. But you also have to go, in a lot of cases, like, what I'm saying is maybe there's somebody who is spending a bazillion feathers and they don't like really have rocks, and rocks are the only way they have to go make a potion. They're having a hard time getting rocks. They're using it on something else, and they're just collecting all these ingredients, and they're never going to make a potion. Like, at least you can spend them for a resource. And, like, a lot of times that's the game's way of saying, like, this is so brutal that you're not using this that we're going to give you something tiny. And, like, it almost kind of emphasizes that, like, if you have a bunch of this stuff, you're doing so bad with it. Because a lot of games do that kind of thing where, like, you can trade, like, yeah, you can spend 3 points to get a coin and it's, like, 1 coin. Yeah, dude, don't run out of coins. And, like, there's some, like, so maybe that's what it is.
Yeah, I don't know. But then, yeah, just like you mentioned, you spend a card and a dude to go randomly draw one out of the bag that could be...
A card and a dude and 3 resources.
Right, yeah.
It just, and maybe 2 dudes if you need one of those things and somebody's already there.
Maybe it's because potions are just so good. Like the
potions did seem good.
The abilities on them was pretty good, yeah.
Yeah.
But that's the weird thing. It's like, I don't want to get something that doesn't work for a potion then.
Yeah, I think I guess I kind of have a rewind to a prawn, because I think this could go into any category for anybody. I feel like there might just be 1 too many things. Because I don't think realistically you do everything in this game ever. Like, you always probably are going to ignore at least 1 facet. And so, like, today I had, like, no artifacts and one
creature.
And so those were 2 facets that I didn't really touch. But, I mean, I did well. Like, you didn't need to. So take that for what you will. I mean, if you're a person that feels like you want to really kind of do everything and, like, be able to get into a lot of stuff, there's just too many things to do that with, and you can't do it because they're spread out amongst all those cards, and you only have so many guys.
Yeah.
So, you know, I think what it boils down to for me is it felt very hard to do what I wanted to do, and I wanted to do all of the things, which, I mean, it's cool because, like, everything was fun to do, but you couldn't even come close to doing it.
And the weird thing is, if you're trying to do 2 things – and those 2 things are on the same card, you can't do both of them. So you have to kind of pick 2 or 3 things that are spread out.
So you spend around getting a card, so the next round you can do. So it almost scripts the first half of the game for you a little bit in a way. Like, you always got to start by doing this, then you got to get cards, and you got to do this. But, oh, no, someone took your spot because you went last, and then you got to give up a guy early, and that didn't feel good.
And then you got to go spend a card to go get 2 guys to even get the guy back.
Yeah. I don't know. The ebb and flow.
There's a lot of not feeling good in the game. That's true. But sometimes I like not feeling good in the game, though.
I don't think it was it wasn't, like, horribly brutal. You could kind of, like, there was still stuff left to do for the most part. But there is certainly.
But then I feel like it really opened up the last 2 rounds.
Right, because you had stuff.
Yeah, I don't know. Like, the first 3 rounds felt really constrictive, and the last 2 rounds felt like.
Yeah.
Plenty of stuff.
I like to make painful decisions. I don't like to just be in a painful position because, like, I was playing the game normally, and then I'm just restricted from doing everything with stuff I still have.
Yeah.
But, like, again, it wasn't like. I think that was, like, the je ne sais quoi from I was feeling about it. There's a lot I think I'm really positive on too, though.
All right, well, why don't we get into final thoughts? Here on the Board Boys podcast, we have a 4 boing rating scale, 4 boings being the best. You can only do that 1 time. Sorry, it's a 3 boing rating scale. Boy, am I tired. So 3 boings being the best, 0 boings being the worst. What did I say earlier that you guys laughed at me for?
He said something none of your guys are jacked up.
So
no, he said you can jack your dudes out.
A 0 boing game is none of your dudes are jacked out.
Yeah, I can't jack your dudes jacked out.
And the 3 boing game is your dudes are all jacked
up. Yeah, you whacked all of them up.
Yeah. They're all jacked up on Mountain Dew. Chet.
Yeah, Code Red.
All right.
Yeah.
Man, Code Red used to be way more present, didn't it?
I think so. I think it still exists, right?
It does, yeah, for sure.
Do you guys remember when 7-Up made that that like extreme version of 7-Up called that it was like DNL, because it was they made the 7-Up logo upside down, so it was like the P was turned into a D, the N turned into a U, the 7 turned into an L.
No.
Also called 7-Upside Down. I drank so many cans of that when I was 16 years old.
You guys remember Surge?
Yeah, bro.
Surge was the last pop I drank, and it was 6 years ago.
Dude.
Oh, yeah, Surge came back. I forgot about that.
Yeah, you went on a terrible note.
It was the Summer Olympics, and I drank a Surge. Our friend Joe, who plays games with us, convinced me that we needed to drink that day. And for just an arbitrary reason, I decided I'm not going to drink another pop till the next Summer Olympics. And then that came and went, although COVID did push that back a little bit. And I just didn't want it anymore, and so I haven't drank it anymore.
That's good. I need to not want pop anymore. I don't really drink a lot of soda, but when I do drink it, I want to drink like a gallon of it.
Yeah.
I love soda.
It's my one vice.
Yeah, for sure.
I have weaned mostly off it by making sure I'm just drinking 2 coffees a day.
All right. I'll start here.
Yeah, do it.
Final thoughts for Oak for me. I'm just gonna make up an arbitrary number now. Get out of my brain. I don't know. I want to play it again. I don't know how much fun I had with the gameplay. I think there's a lot of interesting decisions. God, I just can't decide. I'm glad I didn't back it on Kickstarter. I'm glad I played it, and I'm glad I can play it again. I think I'm gonna drop it in at a 2. It's hanging out at a 2 for me.
Nailed it.
It's not gonna go into my collection, but I would not play it again. And I mean, I had a fine time with it, and maybe it'll open itself up to me a little bit. Like, I really like the dudes, and I really like the idea of jacking them up with their accoutrement.
Yeah,
the accoutrement were cool. Did you con the horn? The horn hood is not in every game.
I did not, but it's 100% the worst part of this game.
That's true. I mean, you should at least be able to put that like the horn helmet on your leader.
Yeah. So there's a helmet that goes on one of your meeples that's like antlers and like a leather hood, or looks like a leather hood or whatever. And the only time you can do that is when there's a certain potion out that lets you do that. And that didn't come out this game, and that sucks.
Yeah, and it obviously is because it makes it like the best dude who's like the wild dude. I think they should have made the staff the wild one, and then had the horn one for like the dude who.
And then on top of that,
real wild one.
What was even more worse, was that we tried to put it on random meeples, and Jake wouldn't let us.
Yeah, we were just like putting him on like the dudes on the tree, and Jake said, "What's that guy doing there?"
Yeah, like, and they took it off.
Yeah.
Yeah. No, he's just jacked out, man.
Those antlers weren't jacked appropriately.
Yeah, that's true. They weren't sharpened enough.
So I'll do some final thoughts. I feel pretty much the same way as Rob. Like, I think this game could go either way for me for multiple plays. I could see replaying this game and it being one of my favorites, and I could see being like, it's all right. You played it how many times?
I played it 3 times now.
Okay. Has it gone up? Have you liked it more the more you played it?
Isn't that a secret?
I think that information is coming out soon. Okay. It has not. I haven't liked it any less any of the times I've played it. Okay. And I've done completely different things every time I've played it.
Why do you think it's better with 2? BGG said better with 2 or 3. Why do you think that might be?
Well, I don't know. I mean, I guess the fact that there's less people to fill the action spaces, but you do put out neutral people that rotate. So I guess the idea that you only have to anticipate where one person's going to go for actions to stop you, because the
three would just
rotate.
3 might be slightly less tight, maybe.
Yeah. So there's still meeples out there with 3 players. Maybe not. I need to look into that. But I know that I played it 2 players, and there was 1 meeple around, and it just rotated which of the 3 spots it was in. But you knew exactly where it was going to be, so you could plan accordingly with that.
Yeah, I just didn't really like giving up that extra guy.
It feels gross to send an extra guy to the roots to do it.
Yeah, because then you got to take an action just to get people back. I don't know. Ugh.
Yeah, for me, I'm going to go, it's a 2 for me. I think it could be a 2.5, maybe even to a 3, if if it grows, it could go down. I mean, it could stay at a 2. I don't think it'd go below a 2, but it was good. Cam?
I had a good time thinking about what I was going to do in this game. I want to play it again.
You want to be those potion boys?
No, I want to be whoever. I don't care. I want to try it again. I did think the potions were really cool in this game. I want to give it a conditional 2, but I'm on the 1.5 side of 2. Just because I think that the gameplay of like the cards and what you can do with each card and putting the workers there is just not compelling to me, and it would be difficult for people I'm like getting to the table with, you know, half the time. Like, I think it'd be like a little too crunchy for that, what you'd call like the average gamer. Like, not crunchy, but like it's just kind of confusing. I don't know. I give it a 2 because I think it's well designed, and I think it has potential, and I think it could go higher, but 2.
I did predict all 3 of you would say 2 before any of you said anything about it, by the way. Did you do your full predictions then as well?
I just put yours in.
Oh, yeah. But I did say 2 for all 3 of you.
Yeah,
so
2 is 2 all.
After being horribly off with what everybody thought on Audubon, I'm glad I'm a little bit closer. So I did play this game with people that don't necessarily really like crunchy games, and they didn't seem lost and enjoyed it. So, I mean, it just kind of depends, I guess. Maybe that was just the right mechanisms to maybe branch into a little bit heavier. For me, it just has all the stuff that I'm looking for in a game. I like things to be unique. Honestly, that's one of the things that I think I look into new games the most for is, does this sound like it's something that's different than things that I have before? And I love games where I can map out everything I'm going to do before I start, and every turn I pretty much try to do that. So I think it's a 3 for me. I put it 3 times.
Sheesh.
It stayed there. I really had a hard time coming up with cons, and I keep wanting to play it. So I guess I don't really know what else a 3 is for me other than that. So I think it's a really interesting design by a first-time game designer, and I'm excited to see what he continues to create.
I was actually thinking about the fact that he's a new designer because I looked at his page. Right after I said 2, and I want to update my score from 2 erring on the side of 1.5 to 2 pointing straight north, because as a first designer, I think that there's a lot of potential with this guy's ideas, so I want to judge it a little less harshly. Like, if this was like the 5th game and I'd played like other really bangers from this designer, I'd be like, eh, not the best one, but I think there's a lot of room to like do cool stuff, and I think there's good fresh ideas from this designer. So let's give it a solid 2.
I think the next time I play this, I'm going to try to just shoot up those tracks and see how that changes the game, because I think it could make it really different.
It could. It maybe could.
Maybe it won't.
All right, right on. I think that wraps up our thoughts for Oak. Cam, do you want to hit us with that bumper dump music?
Yeah, I sure do. What would you do if your bump was a dump? Is it a bump or is it a dump? Cause he's hungry and the only way to feed him is to... I'm not gonna sing the rest of that song. You guys remember that song?
Nope.
I got you.
What would you do if your son was at home crying by
on
City
the bedroom
High
floor?
Baby, turn around, I wanna see that sexy board game go board boys bump.
Or dump.
It was like, that was a couple years before bump, 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 I think.
All right. Here on the Bull Boys podcast, we look back 1 year in the past to a game that we played to see if it has gone up in the ratings or down in the ratings. So 1 year ago, we were playing Boone Lake.
Boone Lake.
That was had an original rating of 7.8, which made it a BGG ranking of 901. Rob, where do you think it's at? Oh, it's at a 7.7 now.
Ginormous bump.
Yeah,
bump,
I mean,
bump.
I think it's bumped.
Bump. I think it's a gigantic bump for the world. I will say, I played that game twice and I was big on it. I was like, this is maybe like, this is awesome. And then I've never played it since.
Mm-hmm.
I need
this
to go back and play it.
I really, really wanted to get back to the table before we did this. And I didn't. So
I straight up bought it because I had so much fun playing it the first time.
I do not own it, so I was unable to get it played.
I own it. Last time I played it was March 15th of 2022. But I really like it. I think it's really interesting, and I would love to play this game again.
You know what? You
sounds
know
like
what
a
has
GameCon special.
Do you know what has made it tricky to get this back to the table? Is the advent of Great Western Trail on BGA. Because, like, this is Boone Lake is like the little sister of the Fister Blasters. Like, it has vibes from Great Western, and it has vibes from the one that I love, whose name I can't remember, Maracaibo.
Yeah.
And it also has kind of some ideas from his other, like, kind of some of the other games that recently came out of his. And I think just it was kind of closer to GWT, but playing so much Great Western Trail on the app, and then when I get a Fister game to the table wanting to play Maracaibo has prevented me from playing Boone Lake, but I'd really love to play it again soon.
Great Western Trail on BGA has made Tim not like Great Western Trail anymore.
As much.
Do you just think shedding cards is too strong?
It's way too good.
Because, like, every time I try to do a builder strategy, yeah, I get smoked, and every time I shed cards, I win by, like, 20 points.
Yeah, it's way too good. Having five cards in your hand for, like, the last half of the game is
Like, every time I just try to shed cards, like, by halfway through the game, I'm just nailing 18
just
every single time.
Yeah, and then you just...
And then I just crushed...
Yes.
They just overcorrected that too
I think
hard
so, yeah.
Correct, yeah. Yeah, because it sucked before, for sure.
I wonder if the expansion kicks it up a little bit.
I hope so. I have it. Yeah. I really want to play Rails of the North.
I mean, if it's the same expansion as it was before, like, it would still be just as good.
Gotcha.
You know... You would just be able to deliver to even cooler places. So
yeah, but maybe Fister, in all of his wisdom and graciousness, played his second edition many times after releasing. It was like, well, maybe I'd have turned up the power of shedding the cards too much, and maybe it's time now to. Well, my German voice is always that voice.
he's got one.
Yeah.
That's it.
Yeah.
Yeah. So either way,
for the record, I don't think Uwe or Steffenfeld sound like that.
I think Alexander Fister was a bump.
Like,
it's at 484 right now. I would play it again. It did feel for me that you could basically do everything in Boone Lake. You got all your stuff out. Everything got done.
I guess on that note, I don't really love that the scoring things at the bottom, like you have to do this or you can't. You have to put a thing out. You're going to get negatives. But those are so minuscule. Like the points you get in the first couple rounds when you have to score something. You know what I'm talking about? The objectives at the bottom. And I was like, man, I felt like that should have been more. I feel like the cow scoring was weird too and hard to count sometimes.
It's been a long time since I played it. Yeah. But as you're putting that thought in my head, I think I kind of remember thinking by the end of the second play that I wish the putting out pieces of wood was much more exciting than it was. It felt like not as cool as it could have been.
Because you could get all your stuff.
And the way the resources worked was kind of didn't really matter at the end either.
And then, yeah, some of the scoring seemed kind of stupidly weighted.
But the switches were fun.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I love pulling them switches.
Mm-hmm. All right, cool. So if you want to give feedback on our bump and dump, you can do that at our Board Game Geek Guild. So Christopher Boat doesn't have a boring rating, but he said it didn't wow him. I think he's probably going to dump his copy.
Think I posted. Yeah. I'll buy your copy.
Buy a copy. Yeah, yeah.
Sell me your copy.
But for
bro,
BJ,
that's one less boat in the Boone Lake.
Yeah, for BJ, it's his favorite Fister. So his quibbles about scoring mechanics aside, the river movement and card play are tight and juicy and crunchy and delicious and scrumptious. And
the river movement
decisions.
And card is my favorite.
He wrote
thing
all
in
those
game
words.
All those words.
All right.
Yeah. Yeah. Tight and juicy and scrumptious. I love BJ.
Did any of them in EAU?
I don't
probably.
Know. I don't know. And then Daniel Simmons. He's hoping it's a bump. Feels like it could be a dump. Going with Cam staple of two boings. He really likes the game, but it feels like a Fister take on a Steffenfeld game. So many levers to pull and adaptive gameplay. He wants to get it to the table again soon.
Actual levers to pull, people.
Yeah, for sure.
Real levers.
Cool.
Dream lever, come rescue me.
Right.
What would you guys do with your life if you could sing as high as Mariah Carey could in the early 1990s? I don't think my life would be that different. You'd say your ooze a lot higher.
What?
You'd say your ooze a lot higher. You'd be like,
hey. I mean, if I could sing that high, you would probably be pretty famous.
Think about that. She could go one full, or is it, I think one full octave above what I'm doing right there, right? Or maybe it's two. I can't even get like five notes above what I was just doing. I'm a little lightheaded.
All right, Rob, hit us with
should the should have ate
dog.
More tendies.
Should have had. I had eight tendies. I ate eight. I ate eight.
Cam, give us a caw and then we'll move on.
Well, I think that's going to wrap us up for another episode of the Board Boys podcast. Remember, you can go out to theboardboys.com, go to all our different links out there, come talk to us on the Discord. You can get there from the website, Facebook, Twitter, Instagram. Hopefully we have some more interesting things coming up soon. We're going to be going, some of us will be at GameCon in Cedar Rapids after this. Hope we played some games with you there if you were there.
Yeah.
But it just means in our next episode, we're probably going to have a lot of games to talk about, would be my guess. So we'll be loaded up for that. I'd like to go through and just remind you that we do have a Patreon. If you'd like to support that, go to the website, click the little pledge page up there. We've got some different levels for you. And hopefully we can start doing some more stuff with it. I'd like to start maybe do some polls on picking games for certain times. I know we have a level where you can kind of pick a game in the rotation too. So let's get going on that. I'd like to thank our patrons currently: Richard Lane, Rob Cooper, BJ from Board Game Gumbo, Braden Dowdy, Jeremy Toman, Andre Bosch, David Dugas, Shifty Teeth. I think that's it. I really got to... That their app really sucks for finding these things. I need to just go make a list of them before the podcast. On the computer, it's much better. Anyway, until next time, we hope you like board games.
Boing, boing, boing. Three boings. Four boings. Party for the world. Que me tiene arrebatado, que me tiene medio loco, que ya estoy enamorado. Quizás serán sus ojitos, o tal vez su caminado, o quizás esas cositas que en su casa ella me ha dado. Que tú me tienes temblando de noche y de día. Tú me hiciste brujería. Me quieres mandar pa' la tumba fría. Tú me hiciste brujería. Bruja, bruja, brujita. Tú me hiciste brujería. Demonio. Tú me hiciste brujería. Me echaste no sé qué en la comida. Tú me hiciste brujería. Siento una cosa fría. Tú me hiciste brujería. Que me va por aquí, se sube por aquí.
I don't know why I want a houseboat.
I don't know why you want a houseboat either. That seems like a gigantic money sink.
Oh, I'm sure it is. Yeah. But like...
I mean, there's dudes, I guess, who live on houseboats like and don't take care of them, and then they're like the crusty guy in movies.
I know, but like I could just like spend my summer out on a houseboat. Hanging out.
I definitely thought houseboats were so cool when I was a kid.
I mean, boats in general are...
pretty tight.
I don't like the sun.
So pretty much money sinks.
I'm an indoor man.
He's an indoor
man. You
can
board game on the water.
Bump, think about bump, how often dump, your pieces would fall dump, off your dump. Board when you're
He's
hitting choppy seas.
A board game,
I mean, it's not like you're tooling around Sailorville Lake and the like. You're like in a little cove.
Are you talking about getting a houseboat?
Yeah, dude.
Oh, yeah. I mean, like the houseboats at Sailorville Lake like never leave.
Yeah.
The marina.
Let's get this 42-foot and we'll
Is
christen
it sitting
it.
There?
Yeah, we'll christen it with the board boys, and then we'll just have board gaming parties on it.
Location
soon. Yeah.
Well, like usually the houseboats, you have to take a little, like you just take a little, like raft out to the houseboat, and then you go on the houseboat and you take a little raft back to the marina. It's usually how that.
Yeah, I mean, at least, you don't actually drive it.
Yeah, yeah, it just sits there. So you just basically buy a house that's hard to get to.
There you go.
Yeah, and then when you poop in it, it goes to the bottom of the lake.
This one has. A 40-gallon freshwater tank, and a porcelain foot-flush toilet.
See? There you go.
Boom. Let's roll. Let's keep moving.
That's what she said.